Kreha towa wania tu in kihe ohukaka obadakinkta. It was getting to be the autumn or the fall time of the year, and the different birds that migrate to the south were all getting ready. They were talking about how they were going to go and kind of getting together. Here this blue heron was standing kind of in the midst and kind of looking around and listening to what everyone was saying. This blue heron made this announcement to everyone who was there. I'm not going to go back south this winter. I'm going to stay here. And all these birds were standing around, the ones that migrate and then some of the ones that stay here, like some of the wrens and the prairie chickens. And they all just kind of looked at him, just very, very surprised. And one of the ones that go south talked to the heron. He said to him, "You know, we never stay here during the winter months. We don't know how it is, and we really can't say, but for some reason, we never stay here." Onka shio na ishki bibija dina wogdakapkam. And the ones that stay here, like the wrens and the prairie chickens, they talk to the blue heron. And one of the birds that stay here then told the blue heron, "Winter here is really terrible. There are the biggest blizzards. It snows so hard and the snowbanks are just deep. And the winds come and the winds are so cold. And the ice on all the lakes and rivers and ponds freezes so thick, there's no way you can make a hole in it." Here the blue heron said, "It might be deep snow, but look at me. I have these long legs and I can just run through the snowbanks and I wouldn't have any trouble. And look at this wren, it's such a little bird. But it goes through the snowbanks and it survives. So I can stay here." Here one of the prairie chickens said to the blue heron, "No, you shouldn't stay. It's really bad here in the winter time. No, you just shouldn't stay." All these ones that migrate gathered together, and every day they were flying toward the south, all of them. The ducks and the geese and all these others were all going. Here they were all gone, the only ones that were here that the ones always stay. And with them was the blue heron. And the blue heron thought to himself, "I wonder what they were talking about. It is so beautiful. The country is so wonderful. The leaves turned brown and red and yellow. And it was just beautiful. I wonder why they all left. It was just so nice and pleasant that he walked along the water banks and he found food and was eating and was just so contented." And it went past the winter solstice time, and it was going into the terrible month, which is called today January. The wind started to get cold, and it started to snow a little bit. But it wasn't really cold, so the waters didn't freeze, and he could still eat, so he was still going along. It was a little bit cold, but not too bad. And all of a sudden, the really cold winds came, and the snows came terrible. And the water started to freeze over. And as the blue heron went along the water shorelines and was trying to break the ice, he kind of injured his beak because the ice was getting thicker and thicker. It was kind of bloody-like at the edges. It went into the month of February, you know, everything was frozen. It was very, very cold, no matter, even if there was kind of a few pleasant days. So the ice didn't melt on the water. And that was his source of food, was the water. And the birds who stay here, they make their feathers kind of in a winter way, but not for the blue heron, because his life was to go to the south in the winter. So his feathers didn't change. So he was just about freezing. He was almost starving to death. And he was just really having a hard time, very cold and very hungry. And he walked by this place where there was a plum thicket. You know, the wild plums, they kind of grow all together in kind of a grove. And the snow was all drifted over this plum thicket. And as he was walking by this plum thicket with all the snow drifted in, well, then he could hear these voices. And he walked around this plum thicket very slowly and just looking very hard. Here, like a doorway, the snow hadn't drifted in. Here from this entryway where the snow hadn't drifted in, he could hear the voices. Here, as he bent way down to go through this entryway, he could see that it was a lodge. And in there was the prairie chicken's winter lodge. And it said that as he got close and the prairie chickens could see him from the inside, one of the women prairie chickens saw him and she said, "Oh, look, Prehantro Ahiokas Inaji, the blue heron is looking in. Timaihed Ushipi," she said, "tell him to come in." And that part is kind of a lesson for us. They knew that this blue heron was not one of their own kind. He was not a prairie chicken. But they didn't think that. They know that we have to have compassion for people who are suffering. So she said, "Tell him to come in." So one of the ones that were closer to the door has told blue heron to come in. "Timaed u koda eapi." They said, "Come in, friend," they said to him. So he went in. And of course, it's a story. So the prairie chickens even had a fire. So they were nice and warm and comfortable. So the blue heron came in and sat close to the fire, warming himself. He got warm and felt a little bit better. But even then, he was very, very hungry. But he didn't let on because he kind of had his pride, I guess. He didn't want to be proven wrong that he should have went south. In order to live in a civilized manner, we have to learn from all of the things around us. And if these are considered to be animals or things that don't have wisdom, today we might think that way, but in the times of our ancestors, they knew that these creatures were wiser than us in many ways, and we had to learn from them in order to live in a good way. We look at this particular part where they invited him in. The prairie chickens didn't say that. They didn't say, "Chase him away. He's not one of us." But no, they invited him in, and every day the prairie chickens went out and they gathered their food. They did all the things they needed to do. And every day the blue heron went out too, and he went along the waters, but the ice was so thick, there was no way that he could get any food, and he was beginning to be starving. And every day the blue heron went out, and of course he never got food, so he got thinner and thinner, and he was starving. And the prairie chickens observed that, and they were getting very, very concerned. They kept asking him, "Are you able to get food?" And he would keep saying yes. But they noticed that his breastbone was getting sharper and sharper and that he was beginning to stagger. One morning they got up and here that blue heron was just laying on his side, couldn't move. Chaptayana wogadakapkab shioki. And this part of these stories are to point out to us that sometimes there are decisions and things that require the input of others, when it's a very, very serious matter, then we get together as a group and we discuss and we listen and we take that action. So the prairie chickens realized that this was a very serious matter. So they had a meeting, all of them in their lodge, and they talked. And the prairie chickens realized that the blue heron would die if they couldn't come up with some solution to the serious predicament he was in. So they had a meeting and they were talking. They knew then that the blue heron got its food from the water, and the ice was so thick there was no way that they could make a hole in it. So they knew then that somehow the ice had to be melted. So how could they do that? The ice was so thick. So they came to the conclusion the only thing that could really help would be that if spring came early that year, wetu is the word for spring. So if spring came early that year, then that's the only way the ice would be melted. Then their next series of discussion was, how can we let spring, or get the message to spring, that it had to come back early this year? Chatuahe chunktahe, who is going to do that, was the next thing they discussed. Who is going to go after spring? Could the coyote do it? And they discussed then the qualifications of coyote to do that. And see, when we are going to make a decision, it's always good to think about the qualifications of who is going to do that. We don't do it because we know that that's a friend or somebody that does things. We have to think about the qualifications. Chayu hanawana, how about one of us? They talked about that. Hia unkokihipteshne, they said they themselves, they couldn't do it. So they agreed then, yes, this one wren, they asked it if it could, and they said, you're capable, and so forth. Oha, eshkibibi eeg hineka dokiut chayakab. And they said, the wren said, yes, I will do it, and it went. And it was about a week, and the poor blue heron was getting weaker and weaker and weaker. And somewhere they could hear this wren saying, it is here, it is here. So they all got happy. And to this day, you can hear that wren say that same thing. And they said spring came and it melted the waters. And of course, they helped the crane, the blue heron, get to the water's edge where it found food and it survived. And in that story, we have to do things. These migratory birds, they fly together. But when you look at the blue heron today, the blue heron is always alone in the waters of our wonderful country here. But there's so many things to learn from our stories, but that's just one. We have to know when we work together, when we have to do things alone. Eho, helhechitu, pidamape, that's the end of the story.